What if we explode an antimatter bomb on Earth? So you saw the title. Yes, we're going to explode things with antimatter. Whenever it comes to something like this, I see you folks get very excited. But I would suggest you all to please stick to more peaceful uses before starting this video. So have you wondered whether something more powerful and destructive than a nuclear weapon exists or not? Well, yes, the destructive potential of antimatter is simply incredible. But how can you build an antimatter bomb and explode it? And what will be the consequences of that? In this video, we're going to fulfill your sci-fi fantasy and talk about building and exploding an antimatter bomb and the difficulties associated with it. And since we at Insane Curiosity love peace, we will also talk about what good use can be made of antimatter and why you should too. Hang on a sec, guys. If you'd like to help improve the quality of our content, please check out the Patreon link below. We would like to say a big thank you to all those who show their support. Antimatter is a very confusing concept for a lot of people. It seems very strange to people. So before talking about using it to spite people, let's know what exactly antimatter is. To put it simply, antimatter is just matter with its electric charge reversed. Antimatter was first theorized in 1928 by Paul Dirac, and in 1932 it was first detected by Carl Anderson, for which he got the Nobel Prize. Thus, humanity recognized the positron, a copy of an electron but with a positive charge. Seems strange, but these particles, which are like mere reflections of matter, do exist. Positrons are produced in the nuclear fusion of our Sun and also at particle accelerators at CERN. And when matter and antimatter meet, they both annihilate each other while emitting powerful radiation and energy. Only half a gram of antimatter is enough to create a bomb that would be 40% more powerful than the bomb dropped on Hiroshima. The annihilation of 1 kilogram of antimatter will produce 10 billion times more energy than 1 kilogram of TNT. This amount of antimatter would be able to break the record set by the thermonuclear Tsar Bomba, tested on the Novaya Zemla Island in 1961. But what about building the antimatter bomb? Because before using its immense potential, you need to build it first. Do you think it's going to be easy? It seems simple enough. Just introduce antimatter with matter and then boom. We can already feel the excitement in you people when you heard about the boom. But building an antimatter bomb isn't so easy. In fact, it's an extremely hard task. It's because antimatter doesn't dominate our universe, and we are all made up of matter, which we should be grateful for. But still, it is present in very small quantities here and there. Rolf Landua, who is a physicist at CERN, says even if you add up all the antimatter we have made in more than 30 years of antimatter physics here at CERN, and if you were very generous, you might get 10 billionths of a gram. Even if that exploded on your fingertip, it would be no more dangerous than lighting a match. I see some disappointment in you guys now. In Star Trek's episode Obsession, 1 ounce of antimatter reacting with matter is enough to blow up half the atmosphere of an Earth-sized planet. But that isn't the case. As we talked earlier, antimatter is more catastrophic than other explosives. But 1 ounce of antimatter isn't enough to cause such havoc, and it isn't as spectacular as science fiction portrays it. As said earlier, antimatter is hard to find and manufacture, and the manufacturing cost would be millions and billions of dollars. But for the sake of discussion, let's imagine a situation where we can get our hands on an adequate amount of antimatter. The next problem we will face is contamination. And in this case, contamination of antimatter would be fatal for us, because we cannot use normal matter-made containers for it, as they will obviously annihilate each other. So how are we going to store it? Well, antimatter in the form of charged particles can be contained in an electric field in a device called a Penning trap. Just make sure you keep the power supply on. Such a trap uses the dipole movement of the trapped particles. In 2011, scientists at CERN were able to preserve antihydrogen for approximately 17 minutes. The record for storing antiparticles is currently held by the TRAP experiment at CERN. Antiprotons were kept in a Penning trap for 405 days, so this gives you enough time to unleash wrath on Earth by building your bomb. So as we talked earlier, now you have an adequate amount of antimatter and also are able to contain it. Now it's time for you to fulfill your evil sci-fi fantasy. So how much destruction is it going to cause? Well, unfortunately, we have a reference point. The Tsar Bomba is the most powerful nuclear device ever created, which had 60 megatons of energy, which is equivalent to 2,000 Hiroshima bombings. The destruction caused by this bomb is equivalent to a 1.5 kilogram antimatter explosion. You might want to stand back for this. Even the aliens would think, who does this to their own planet? But what if you increase the quantity of antimatter, for example, to 10 kilograms? This amount of antimatter would cause nearly the same destruction as the 2004 Indian Ocean earthquake, whose epicenter was located off the northwestern coast of Sumatra in Indonesia and caused the deadliest tsunami in modern history. The magnitude of this earthquake was about 9.2. The movement of lithospheric plates created waves with a height of more than 15 meters. The tsunami reached the shores of Indonesia, Sri Lanka, southern India, Thailand, and many other countries, killing about 300,000 people. This earthquake was so powerful that the shockwaves from this passed through the entire planet, and the islands located near the epicenter shift tens of meters. According to theoretical models, the mass shift in huge energy release equivalent to 480 megatons of TNT slowed the Earth's rotational speed slightly, reducing the length of our day by about 2.68 microseconds. A similar force can be expected from an explosion of only 10 kilograms of antimatter. The creation of an antimatter bomb is only erratic in practice. Obtaining antiparticles is very time-consuming, complex, and an expensive undertaking. The European Center for Nuclear Research, or CERN, uses the Large Hadron Collider, a charged particle accelerator, to create and study antiprotons. According to a CERN employee physicist, the synthesis of 1 gram of antimatter with current technology would cost about $1,000 trillion. For comparison, the annual U.S. budget would be enough to create only a few micrograms of antimatter. Another natural disaster, the biggest one that we know of, is the asteroid, bigger than Mount Everest, that wiped off dinosaurs 65 million years ago. If you'd like to see an apocalypse, then detonate 2.5 kilotons of antimatter, which will release an energy comparable to 100,000 megatons of TNT and would trigger the onset of a new ice age. The hot debris from the impact soared high into the atmosphere, and beyond falling back, this debris heated the air to the temperature of the inside of an oven. A large amount of dust fell into the atmosphere, which for several years blocked the Earth's surface from the sun, causing a nuclear winter and killing most of the life on Earth. Such is the power of antimatter. Scientists at the University of Michigan have built a handy antimatter gun. And although it's called a gun, it really isn't a gun. In reality, it is a mini positron creator. Instead of using the huge particle accelerator at CERN to make positrons, this device can create and spew short bursts of positrons. The team at the University of Michigan followed the work done by researchers at the University of Texas and built a device less than a meter long that generates both short bursts of electrons and positrons. Though the emissions last just 30 femtoseconds, they produced quadrillions of positrons. This number is comparable to the ones created at CERN. With the emissions from these guns, you cannot do harm to your colleagues at work, but the emissions are very similar to what makes up the jet streams from black holes and pulsars. By studying how the device works, questions about the energy composition and how the particles in the streams interact with outside environments can be answered. But as we said in the beginning, let's stick to more peaceful uses. So what better use of antimatter than using it as a fuel? NASA's interest is caused by the fact that antimatter could be the ultimate rocket fuel. Antimatter is also an ideal super-efficient fuel. An antimatter engine would be the most efficient ever created, because 100% of the mass of the substance and antimatter is converted to energy. The current estimate is that antimatter could get us to Mars in 6 weeks, as predicted by the design team at Penn State. The benefits of using this as a fuel are immense. With just a tiny amount of antimatter, we can send off a nuclear reaction, also known as antimatter initiation microfusion. Theoretically, apart from being a great catalyst for our bomb, it can also be used as spacecraft fuel. matter-antimatter annihilation releases the most energy per unit mass of any known reaction in physics. A spacecraft powered by this method would require as little as 1 microgram of antimatter, varying according to the length of the mission. The process is super efficient. The energy released when matter and antimatter collide is about 10 billion times the amount released by traditional hydrogen and oxygen combustion. There has been a design of antimatter storage rings proposed by the scientist at Penn State. This design can be used in building modern-day spacecrafts. The entire antimatter engine itself would consist of a few components, including a magnetic feed system, a magnetic rocket nozzle, thruster, and storage rings. The only obstacle to the creation of mega-powerful weapons or fuel is the inability to synthesize antimatter in large volumes. For all the time spent on these efforts, people have only created an insignificant and small dose, 19 nanograms of antiparticles. This is barely enough to boil a cup of coffee. But if we learn to capture more antimatter from space, it will present a new obstacle for us. The consequences of such a technology, if it falls into the hands of a terrorist organization, can be fatal for humanity. This presents tremendous opportunities for the future, and it will be interesting to see how we use the technology and whether science prevails peacefully or blows up in our face. Discussing this as a sci-fi fantasy is a different thing. But what if we are able to harness the energy of antimatter? Will this someday destroy us or become the strongest energy catalyst for our development as a species? Let us know what you think in the comment section below. Also, make sure to like our video and subscribe to our channel, as it encourages us to keep making amazing videos like this for you.